Hachette Audio presents Beat the Devils, written by Josh Weiss, read by Fred Berman. I have here in my hand a list of 205 people that were known to the Secretary of State as being members of the Communist Party, and who nevertheless are still working and shaping the policy of the State Department. Senator Joseph McCarthy, Republican, Wisconsin. I have to turn my head until my darkness goes. The Rolling Stones. My fellow citizens, I stand before you today, humbled and extremely grateful that the American people saw fit to elect me as president of this great nation. I will do everything in my power to live up to the pedigree of this, the highest office in the land, to protect you from threats both foreign and domestic. Today, if you'll allow me, I would like to touch upon the dangers facing us here at home. We are locked in a life or death struggle against a great evil. And what is that evil's name? Communism. I have witnessed its growing tendrils firsthand and know, just as you do, that something must be done. The fact that I stand here today proves that. This is our day, our celebration. The Democratic Party, the party of communism, has attempted to stymie my efforts toward making this country great by ridding it of Stalin's proxies. They tried to silence my necessary warnings through a combination of censure and mudslinging. They and their rag known as the Daily Worker have used my surname to birth a phrase that I shall not utter aloud here so as not to evoke the tarnishing and insulting intimations it carries. If getting a bit rough with communists is un-American, then I must plead guilty to being un-American. Needless to say, the Democrats, with their lynching bees and slander, have shown themselves to be under the complete domination of the communistic Frankenstein which they themselves have created. They shouldn't be called Democrats. They should be referred to properly as the Commiecrat Party. The true, democracy-loving people of this great land have woken up from the Commiecrat spell, a dangerous form of witchcraft known only to a select few who walk among us with names like Rosenberg, Sobel, and Greenglass. These foreign parties look like us. Oh yes, make no mistake about that. But they do not share our ideals of democracy and capitalism. They are wolves masquerading as sheep, pilfering our scientific secrets and poisoning the minds of today's youth with the godless ideology of the USSR and its satellite states. They are a parasitic force upon our American way of life. House committees and hearings have proved to be ineffective when it comes to weeding out the traitors. Those countermeasures do not go far enough. I can pick out anyone in this crowd gathered here today and ask them, are you now or have you ever been a communist? Whatever answer they might provide is beyond worthless, because if that poor soul does worship at the altar of Joseph Stalin, well, you know what they say about the devil being the father of all lies. A communist cannot change their ways any more than a leopard can change his spots. The momentum of their past acts, I believe, carries them onward. Macbeth put it best. I am in blood stepped in so far that should I wade no more. Swift and thorough action must be taken to prevent a catastrophic decline of American society and its foundational principles. I promise with every fiber of my being to crush the vice of communism and deviancy, and that begins with purging our government of any subversive agents that might wish to do us harm. A man chosen by the American people to guard the watchtower of freedom is expected to fulfill certain responsibilities. Unless that man has the intelligence to recognize the traitors and, if I may use a word that we use in Wisconsin, unless he has the guts to name them, then he should be taken down from that watchtower and should not be representing the American people. I will always give up the names of traitors and communists, no matter how important the positions in which they are discovered. And the battle against the Marxists does not end at our borders. Even now, the conflict in Korea rages on with no end in sight. Even now, the Red Menace mocks the United States' inability to stem the flow of communism at home and abroad. How many American men must die to satiate the bloodlust of the Soviet Union and its Bolshevik allies? Mothers who have lost sons are now wondering why we didn't follow General MacArthur's sensible theory of hitting back hard. Some say that if we hit back with excessive force, if we try to win this war, we might make the Chinese communist mad. Now, why we should worry about making someone mad when they're blowing the heads off our boys, I don't know. No more, my fellow citizens. No more. No more shall the hammer and sickle loom over this great nation like a threatening rain cloud. There are brighter days ahead. I promise this to you, or my name is not Joseph Raymond McCarthy. President Joseph McCarthy's inauguration remarks. Delivered January 20th, 1953. Part 1. July 1st, 1958. What sort of day was it? A day like all days, filled with those events that alter and illuminate our times. And you were there. Walter Cronkite. Chapter 1. In the beginning, there was the shovel, and then there was the darkness. That's where the world ended for Morris Baker. But it's also where it began. It was the impenetrable darkness that roused him from a paralyzing abyss of memory. Well, the darkness and the ringing of that damn telephone. It was Tuesday. He knew it was Tuesday because an empty bottle of peach schnapps lay on his nightstand. He always drank peach schnapps on Monday nights, just like his father before him. Except that his father hadn't been a vicious drinker. Who was he kidding? Morris Baker drank peach schnapps every night and most of the day, for that matter. He knew he had woken up on a Tuesday because the government-issued Norman Rockwell calendar sticking to his grease-stained refrigerator told him so. The picture for the month of July consisted of two proud Americans, a husband and wife, in conservative swimsuits lounging on a tropical beach, clinking their martini glasses together. In the distance, a sad-looking couple dressed in drab gray uniforms were bound in chains that bore the hammer and sickle insignia of the Soviet Union. Set against the cloudless blue sky above the two couples in red, white, and blue lettering were the words, "The Freedoms of Capitalism," traced in a bold black outline. Baker saw two identical versions of the calendar, thanks to the schnapps, but he was just able to make out that it was the first day of July and that, shit. The phone was still ringing. He rolled over and stretched his arm off the bed, blindly feeling around for the receiver as the naked woman lying next to him stirred faintly. Baker fumbled with dirty socks, a crumpled chocolate bar wrapper, and a neglected guide called How to Recognize a Communist in 10 Easy Steps, published by the government's official newspaper, Counterattack. Since David Shine was a Jew, his once prominent definition of communism had been rendered incomplete, inaccurate, and in dire need of updating for the safety of the nation. Finally, Baker found the phone with his calloused fingers. "Yeah," he grunted. His mouth was dry and sour from the schnapps, which also turned his head into a pounding drum of bad life decisions that paraded by with each beat. He looked up and squinted, sucking in a hiss of discomfort. Daylight exceeding the recommended dose for his hangover blasted his constricted pupils.
"Baker, hope I didn't wake you," said his partner Brogan Connolly from the other end.
He didn't sound very apologetic.
"No. I was having an early brunch. Lucille Ball is here. I really am preoccupied at the moment. Please do call later."
He'd lived in America for over 10 years, but still couldn't shake his Czechoslovakian accent, which turned words like was and the into vas and z.
Not interested in your lip, Baker, replied Connolly. I need you in Echo Park pronto. I can hear that slur in your voice, by the way. Put the damn schnapps bottle down and get over here.
What is it that couldn't wait for me to actually be on duty, Connolly?
Two stiffs. Double homicide.
So? We get homicides all the time. It's our department, for Christ's sake.
First off, his name is Jesus. Secondly, don't take the Lord's name in vain, or I'll be first to teach you a lesson with the Dublin twins. And yeah, we get murders all the time. But it's not every day that you come across a journalist for a big-time network and a washed-up motion picture director. Can't make heads or tails of it. Just thought you'd want to know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.